All right, so we're getting down to the end here. And I figured I would save some of the straight-up questions that I get the most. And I will do my best to answer these. But again, as I said, you got questions to ask. So the first and the biggest is, do you feel jealousy? Holy crap, yes. I think it's impossible to be a human being and not feel jealousy. Everybody does. It's an emotion, it's a human emotion, and it's perfectly natural. We feel it since we were children. It happens. The question isn't whether I feel jealousy, it's what I do about it. And then, that gets into some interesting facts, I guess, about my personal relationship. Again, I cannot speak for everyone. In poly community, and I can't even speak for other relationships. I can only speak for who I am. I do not feel jealous over Matt having sexual relations with other people, other women. Never bothered me. I have physically pushed him towards other women who were giving him very clear signals. It's never been a problem. What I am jealous about are things that are special to Matthew and I. Like, there is a bed and breakfast in New Hampshire that we go to every Valentine's Day, and if he took someone else there, I would feel really bad because those are where our memories are. But if they chose a different bed and breakfast, I would not feel bad about that. That would not feel bad to me. Another thing is like restaurants that have significant meaning to us, places that have meaning. I just the emotional side of things for me is where my jealousy tends to reside. Some of the places. So, I'm gonna tell you a little story. Either just before or just after we got married, Matt and I were living together, and we were riding in the car one night. And he casually let slip that he had had dinner with his ex-girlfriend in Pittsburgh. And this was before we were like fully open. We were already kind of open at that point, so it wasn't like a giant bomb or anything. And there had been no romantic or sexual situations going on with that. But he just kind of said, "Oh yeah, I went to dinner with this person." And I had to stop for a minute, and he hadn't mentioned it before, which wasn't necessarily a crime. But the thing that bothered me wasn't that he went to dinner with her, it wasn't that they were exes, it was that she ended up sitting in my seat in the car. And that was when I realized that I have jealousy over weird, weird things that, like, not a lot of people think about. Apparently, my seat in the car is a thing. I've been working on that a little bit, but just know that if you and me are in a car, you and I are in a car together, and somebody else is driving, and I give you the front seat, I like you. Like, I like you, like you. I would take a bullet for you. That's how much I like you. So think about that. So yeah, so I do have jealousy. It does happen sometimes. Mostly what I do with that is I communicate if it's a problem, and then I trust Matt to help me either get through it or to resolve it or whatever. One of the other questions that I get in relation to that is, don't you feel jealous when Matt goes out on a date and you have to stay home alone? And the answer to that is, sometimes. Yeah, I'm lucky that I'm not a person who needs constant stimulation, so I can entertain myself for a few hours. But if it gets to that situation, I might, use a Lush, one of my bath bombs from Lush and listen to some of my favorite music as loud as I want, or watch some TV programming that, like, Matt doesn't really like, and just kind of binge watch that, and maybe order myself some food or make my favorite food here. And just, have a fun night where I don't have to kind of be conscious of somebody else at that point. And it's kind of nice, I don't like doing it like all the time. If I had to do it 6 nights a week, I'd probably be like, okay, this isn't fun anymore. But for the most part, I'm not the person who needs to constantly go out anyway, so that's very helpful in our dynamic. And then, you know, one of the other things that we do arrange when we're very active in that sense is we have our own date night once a week. And so that can kind of combat that whole, oh, I didn't get to go out while you went out four times or whatever. And you also don't keep score. You learn how to, like, you learn to undo that habit if that's a thing. That was a thing for me. Gotten better over time. But yeah, and you'd be really surprised, like, if you have one date night, if I have one date night with Matt in a week, you know, I'm around seeing other people, you get really aware of the time you're spending with them, and you put a lot more focus and energy into being with them at that particular point. Not that we're slagging by any means, even now that we're not currently active, but it tends to make you a better spouse. It tends to make you really aware of the time that you're spending with that person and to make it more meaningful and counting. And I think, for us, that's been an amazing thing. And, you know, like I said, we're constantly getting an infusion of new energy incoming all the time. So sometimes we explore new things together and, as an influence from somebody else. So it's great. I mean, it's wonderful. But yes, to answer the question, one second. To answer the question, jealousy does come up. And we talk about it. We talk about it and resolve it and find ways to work around it, because we're human beings and it happens. Cheating. So one of the other things that constantly comes up, and a lot of people just, I don't know if they're not aware of it, but they say, oh, so you're allowed to cheat. No. Because there are ways of cheating in polyamory. I think I mentioned this before, but whenever I talk to my monogamous friends and they mention that they've been cheated on, the problem generally isn't the fact that an act of sexual relation took place. It's that somebody lied. Somebody broke trust, broke faith, you know, and acted really shady and hurt them, and that's not okay. And you can still do that in polyamory. You can do that by not following the rules and being a jerk. So I don't view what I do as cheating, and I feel it's kind of insulting to say that I am, because I'm very communicative about the things that I do. My husband and I are both very honest. Everything and everyone I have done in the last 7 years, he's known about since we decided to start this whole thing from the very beginning. And vice versa, and it's not something we're afraid to tell the other person about. It's not something where we punish each other about because it happens. It used to be where we would tell each other exactly before it happened that it was gonna happen. Not that we were gonna cheat, but rather like, hey, I'm going on a date and it might turn into this. Now it's just if we come home and we say, hey, it was or it wasn't. Nobody feels like they're going to get punished. And that's the important part. Because it's not a punishable thing. We're not hurting each other. We're not lying about it or doing a don't ask, don't tell situation. We know what's going on. So to call it cheating and equating it with that broken faith and that broken trust it's not fair. It's a really unfair parallel to make. So no, I do not cheat. I do not have permission to cheat. Cheating inherently is not permit. Like, you can't have permission to cheat. It's not a thing. So, yeah. If that makes any sense. On the other hand of that, I have people that are worried that I will become a homewrecker or be a homewrecker. Most of the time, this comes from women who already know me. And if I already know you, I already know whether or not you're okay with your husband or your wife cheating on me, or cheating on you with me. I already know. So if I already know that answer is no, I'm not even gonna think about it. Like, No, that doesn't happen. I'm not about that life. I would never be about that life. And I would seriously suggest that whoever was propositioning me perhaps go see a counselor and figure out why this is a thing for them. But every once in a while I do get into a mood, and if I meet somebody that I don't know and there's good chemistry, I'm going to ask a few questions of them. Are they with someone? And if so, what is that situation? I look for red flags. If they say my wife doesn't understand me, or they have a wedding ring track but not a wedding ring on, or hair ties in their car or something that suggests a woman is around, but they're not being forthright about that. It's dead in the water. I'm not going to pursue that. I will get out of the car, just end the situation right there. I'm not going to do anything if I have a doubt that that person is with somebody else and that that somebody else does not know. I would not do that to another human being. That's just gross. But if I ask and they say no, there's not a lot I can do about that, you know? I have to trust that people can be honest with me as adults. I'm not gonna call their mother and ask for 4 personal references to do something. And if I, like I said, if I get that doubt, if I get that hint that maybe they're doing something they shouldn't be doing, it stops. I don't continue with that and be like, oh, well, I'm in for a penny, in for a pound now. It'll stop. But some people are just really good at lying, and I can't change that fact. I can't make people be honest. So I do my due diligence, and I pay attention, and that's about all I can do. So I really hope that at least alleviates some fears. I know that some of you do have trust issues with your significant others around cheating. I'm just gonna say right here, right now, that's a problem whether you're in a monogamous relationship, single, or in polyamory. So that's not anything I can control. Just know that I'm doing my best to not be that person that your significant other might try to cheat on you with. But I'm human, and I can only do so much.